think I'm about to form a squadron.
Excuse me, Major, but I happen to know a few things about the protocol. To begin with, they don't let majors set up air combat squadrons. And secondly, all squadrons are formed in the Pentagon. That's protocol.
I never pay any attention to protocol.
Where are you going to get your pilots? All the guys out here are attached.
Not those.
You're kidding. Those guys are all screw-ups.
So am I.
This is a winner. I thought it up myself.
That's just great, Pap. You're nuts.
Hey, look. Yeah. Hey, Pappy came up with the plan.
Yeah. a man called Sloan will return.
I dare you to knock this off. I dare you to compare anybody's batteries, anybody's, with alkaline power cells and try to beat them for long life. You know what? You can't. When you want long-lasting energy, you can't buy a longer-lasting all-purpose power system than gold, red, and black alkaline power cells from EverReady. The power cell that dares to compare. Come on. I dare you.
Hey, Maddox, I'm an actor. I was just playing a part, that's all.
What I meant to say was that I drove out to Parker Motors, but when I got there, Parker's car was gone, so I assumed that he left for the day. And since my original statement to you was verbal, you must have misunderstood what I said. Now, if you claim otherwise, I'm going to deny it. Is that clear?
That's very clear.
I don't care what you think. I don't care what you suspect. I don't care what visions you see when you look at your cigar ashes, because I'm innocent. I have an alibi for the time Gene Stafford died. Now, you can huff and puff on that rotten cigar until next July, and you'll never prove otherwise.
I wouldn't count on it.
Columbo, if you are smart, I won't be seeing you again.
And I tell you, it is a land fit only for savages.
And you have seen what they are like. They are very curious how slowly a man can die. And if you survived Indians and the elements, there are the animals, wolves that run in whole packs, and snakes that strike from me to you and plant their fangs to pump their poison. You find that amusing, monsieur?
Just wondering why you're going back.
Because I am a simple man, monsieur. Without a profession, without an education, I know only the woods.
I never laid a hand on her. I swear I never laid a hand on her. I don't hit women. I got too much respect. Besides, I loved her.
You take on these kids, you're asking for trouble.
You're wrong. I already have trouble. And the only thing that makes it worse is people making more of me being in this wheelchair than is really necessary.
I'm just not getting through to you, am I?
I'm afraid you're a little late. You see, I didn't want this job. But now I'm committed to it for 6 weeks. Goodbye, Mr. Turner.
Don't be so nervous.
Why? Why should I be nervous?
You are, and you reach for that gun, man, and I'm gonna blow you away. Why are you following me?
I'm not following you.
Son, you lie to me, I'm gonna spit in your face and kick you in the balls. Now, who told you to follow me?
Hey, fuck you. Oh!
Let's start all over again.
Oh, please.
Why am I?
Mr. Sherlock and Mr. Holmes.
I just want to ask you some questions.
Perhaps I can help you.
I'd love to have you help me, but this is a personal matter.
She worked here 15, 18 years ago. Well, Miss Cocohead of 1910, Pearl Baker might remember. She owns this joint. Me, I only been here 2 weeks myself.
First I look hungover, now stupid. A bad light in here can cost you a couple of teeth. I don't go around paying $20 for nothing. Now, dig it up.
Oh, I'm a bachelor.
Oh, yes, these bachelors are really experts on marriage.
That's right. And when we stop being experts, we stop being bachelors.
But you're leaving me before the party's over.
There's dinner tonight, and then, well, there's after dinner.
It was like being in the Garden of Eden before there was sin, before the word was even invented.
I guess I was almost in love.
Almost, Tom?
Well, she's only 17, Susie.
I'll practice my breathing.
Good, good. So will I.
Whatever gave you that idea? Goodbye.
We haven't settled anything about you-know-what yet.
I'll talk to you later about it. Goodbye.
You bet you will. Excuse me.
Aloha.
How'd you get in here?
I walked in.
Are you friendly?
Yes. Walk out, Charlie.
Well, then if you're a friend of his, why don't you haul your carcass over there and sit next to him like a friend?
Didn't like my attitude, so he took a swing at me.
Oh, that was a mistake.
I'm going to be married, and I'm going to be living there with my husband. Perhaps with 10 children. And my husband's going to be a gentleman like Mr. Lloyd. A gentleman who will appreciate the arts and the finer things in life.
I've got a crush on you, sweetie pie, all the day and night time. Hear me sigh. I never had the least notion that I could fall with so much emotion. Could you coo? Could you care for a cunning cottage? We could share the world. Will pardon my mush, 'cause I've got a crush, my baby, on you.
I'm sorry, Carter. I don't need any more private detectives.
I wanted to talk to you about Sam Bates.
Who?
Well, Sam Bates is a private detective, a friend of mine. Body was found this morning. He was killed about 2 weeks ago.
I never heard of him.
You're a liar.
What did you call me?
I called you a liar.
Notice first in a woman?
Her lips, her eyes, her hair, her figure. Not necessarily in that order.
Well, that's an interesting way to overcome an enemy.
Mm.
For some reason, bathing invariably gives me an appetite.
It often has the same effect on me.
Wonderful. Then we can have dinner tonight. We can share a finger bowl.
Hardly. We haven't been properly introduced.
Take it and put it in the lock and press the button on the end of the pencil.
What'll happen if I do?
There'll be a big light. Like fireworks.
Honest?
Honest.
Oh, that'll be fun.
At your friendly neighborhood pawnbroker.
I knew it! I should have killed you myself when I had you in that laboratory.
Changed my mind. I thought it all over, and I want my money back.
Mr. West, you are formidable.
I drink a lot of milk.
Oh, what can I say? What can anyone say at a time like this? You are a brave man, James, and a true blue friend. And I'll never forget you for this. Never, never.
Artie, I better dress before you have me in tears.
Questions that we've already gotten from the audience. I love this question. Was who got more girls, James Kirk of the Starship Enterprise or James West? We just saw who got more girls. Who's ready to be a living legend, ladies and gentlemen? Robert Conrad. This is a real treat for me, too. Like all of you, I'm a huge lifelong fan of this man, and I want to thank him again for being here. If you don't mind, one more time, Robert Conrad.
Thank you very much. I'm very sincere when I say that. I've always loved an audience, even when I was a boot truck driver. I was always very happy when I was delivering the milk, and she would say, thank you. And he would come out and say, what do you do here? And I would say, well, I'm your milk man. He said, she used to be. Now, can I get this mic lower just a little bit? Alita, would you do that over there? Can you lower this? This is Alita. She's my assistant. She's a wonderful lady. Not my girlfriend. Yet. I'm going to try to steal a page from James Lipton. You've seen the Actor's Studio, I'm sure, Robert, before. And we're going to start, once we get the mic the way you like, in the beginning. It's always a good place to start. Someone's got a phone ringing.
Oh, yeah.
I can't do it. That means she's fired.
Switch.
It can't be done. Egocentric witch.
Switch.
I cleaned it up. I took the B off.
The honeymoon's over. So we're going to start at the beginning. That's a good place to start, right, Mr. Conrad? You got it like you like it over there?
No, but I'm going to take my glasses off.
Switch.
Wait a minute, let me see. I'll be back. Then I can see it.
And we're going to start at the beginning. You were born Conrad Robert Falkowski, is that correct?
No, that's not correct.
No? And that's Conrad.
I was born Conrad Robert Norton Falk. Conrad was after my grandfather, and Conrad Robert was after my uncle. Norton was after the doctor who delivered me, and Falk was after my father.
The Conrad when you were born with Conrad with a K, though, right?
It was F-A-L-K, a simple name.
No, I mean Conrad was spelled with a K.
It wasn't spelled C-O-N-R-A-D.
So they've screwed up everything online about your life, basically.
Yes, my mother was 15, not 16.
No, I knew she had that. I had 15, I knew that. Now, we do know you were born March 1st, right? That makes you a Pisces. Do you put any stock in that zodiac? Well, do you believe it? Do you believe it at all?
Where the hell did you come from?
Well, I'm not a Pisces. How many people are Pisces like Mr. Conrad? Look at that. You've got a lot of them. Did you know that they say the Pisces is the saint and the sinner? Do you think
yes!
Yeah, the saint and the sinner. You know, according to AOL, and I don't believe anything they say anymore, but anyway, according to them, the Pisces, they say there are more millionaires in the world that are Pisces, but there are also more people in jail that are Pisces.
I did both.
See? There you go.
Yeah, that did.
The same thing the same. The
jail was in France, it was in Paris. And I'm going back to France at the end of the summer.
Oh, because they've embraced my career more than the...
God's
your name. Anyway, they embarrassed me with having this so high. They must have thought I was taller. Anyway, I go back to France, but I did have a bad experience there in Paris with a beautiful lady. And Medicine General until TWA got me out, and they got me out the same day I went in. And what happened was that we had been on a tour of this beautiful lady, I won't mention her name, but I saw her recently. But anyway, we were on a tour, and we had just come from Egypt. And we were waiting in Paris to go to Madrid, and then from Madrid home. Well, when we were ready to board the airplane, he said, no, monsieur. I said, excuse me, what? He said, no. You're not on this flight. I said, yeah, I'm on the flight. We're going about 10 hours out there to get on this airplane. And then he made the incredible mistake. He took his left arm and put it on my chest. And that was the last thing he remembered. And then I got hit with a thing called a sap. And it bounced off my head. And that was the last thing he remembered. So anyway, when I got out, that's why I was incarcerated. I got out and I went to Madrid and I called a friend of mine, and he used to be my best friend. He was absolutely my best friend. We didn't anymore. We had a misunderstanding. Anyway, I called him and I said, listen, RJ, can you send me $250? I want to get to New York and then go home. He said, sure, no problem. So I said, let's hit the Hilton Hotel in Madrid and I'll wait for the money to come. He said, okay, fine, no problem. So I walked down into the bar and there's this agent. He says, oh my God, you're on my list. I said, what list is that? I thought you just got out of jail. It's me and Al Capone or who, you know. And he said, no, and he showed me a list of 10 actors and I was number 5. He said, be the first boyfriend of this actress named Marisol. And I said, okay. He said, just, how old are you now? I said, I'm 28. And well, she's 15. I don't know if that'll work. I said, no. I think it's against the law, but whatever you want to do. And he said, let's have a photo op. So we brought in Manuel Goyanes, who had before it won the Academy Award Best Foreign Film. And he said, let's do the photo op. And then this a Mercedes showed up with two guys, one on the left side, one on the right side, this beautiful young girl. I have a picture of her. Now, Lita, where's the picture of her? Anyway, you won't be able to see it way out there, but matter of fact, if you want, I'll hand it to you, and you can pass it out. This was given to me by a French friend, and as a reward for his generosity, I'm going to go to France and visit with my French fans. It's just been absolutely marvelous to me. But anyway, so the two guys were her bodyguards. They were my old grandma's sons. We took the photo out and they said, perfect. She looks 18, you look 23. And I did a movie with this woman and she became the most successful Spanish actress in the history of film. And she's now retired and she has three beautiful daughters. They're all actresses. Her husband died 6 years ago. And I'm going to go to France and thank my French audience, which is the biggest audience. I've been voted number one foreign actor there for years, which is something that's absolutely wonderful for me. So I'm just going there and thank them. I'm not going to take advantage of the free airfare or the lodging. I'm just going to go over on my own and let those people that have been my fans know I'm there and we'll visit. And then I'm going to Malaga in Spain just to say hello to Marisol. And she now has a restaurant and she has a street named after her. And she's obviously in her 60s and I can't wait to see her. So she's on the, hang on, can you open this gap? Anyway, we're coming through to show you this picture of this woman. She's absolutely one of the most beautiful women I've ever seen.
There she is.
Yeah, here she is. This is the actress, and The film is called La Nueva Cenicienta, and even though it's in Spanish, if you want to see a classic musical, she married the guy, Antonio, who was a ballet flamenco dancer, and she was flamenco, and she was also a singer, and I sing with her, and all the songs that I sing with her, I sing in Spanish, and that went very well received over there. I'm very thrilled to share that with you, and this is her. And if you'll come up, you can pass this out to the audience if they want to go through this. Alina, you want to hand this? Do you want to come and get it? What do you guys, come on, get this. hang on, there she is. And then you can come through this if you want. Javier sent this to me, and he's one of my French fans, so I'm going to share that with you. And all the singing that I do is all in Spanish, and I'm going to do an album this spring, singing, which is what I started to do when my career began when I was 19 years old. And I'm going to do maybe one song in Spanish and the rest, of course, in English. And I've asked my radio audience to send me the songs that they like, and those are the songs that I will do. So I'm getting a lot of songs from that audience, and when I get them up, I will go in and I'll record, because that's what I started doing with my career.
Yeah, in fact, some of the questions were about that. Your mother was a PR rep for Mercury Records.
Yeah, my mother was a PR, yeah.
Is that where you think you got your first love? Because your first love was singing in terms of show business, right?
No, you were right. My first love was my mother. And my mother, Jacqueline, was her name, J-A-C-Q.
You released several recordings, in fact.
I had done a lot of records. Then I did some for Mercury. But what happened there is there was a very popular singer coming up. And God, he was popular. Like, it wasn't my kind of music, so I did what my daughter did just recently. I quit. I said, I can't sing this stuff.
Right.
And I met this guy at a football game, and his name was Elvis Presley.
Someone in the audience, Robert, wanted to know what is your favorite song or favorite type of music?
The kind we just talked about, you know, standards like That's All, and you name it, it's a little classic, and that's a song I like, and that's what will be in the album.
And another question
after time, you know that, right?
Right.
I tell myself that I'm so lucky to be having you.
Yes. Another question to the audience was, how come you haven't sung in a show since Hawaii and I?
Well, it's hard to sing during the Wild West. I mean, I was kind of flying all over the room. Let me knock you out and sing to you.
Now, is it true that you should have, I'm going to ask everything starting with the question, is it true, since obviously I'll have it, but you changed your name according to an interview you did once. You married very young for the first time, too.
Yes,
you took the girl to another town, was very young, and you wanted to stay low on the radar. It was said that that's when you changed to another color.
No, that's not true.
No?
No, I'll tell you the truth. I swear to tell you the truth, all truth and nothing but the truth, because you're here, because I'm here, and I'm very flattered that you're here. So that's why I want to share with you the honesty. Now, in my left foot, I had surgery on my knee from those stunts, and it was significant surgery. It starts here and ends somewhere down there, and they put me in the hospital, and what they didn't do is flip me, so I developed a med psoriasis. Thank you. And it was the size of a half dollar, now it's the size of a dime. So when Alina helps me walk, it's not because I have to be walking my back. It's because I got a dime in my foot that I'm trying to do. Hello. And Alina is, like I said, my sister, lovely girl, but we're not engaged yet. Working on it. There's only 52 years difference. Oh, wow. What does that mean? All right, go ahead. Now, Jackie was my mom's name, and no, she actually started out as a beautician, you know, doing makeup for women. And then she got an opportunity to do publicity for Mercury Records. And in 1947, she was voted the most successful woman in that business for Mercury Records, and she was the only woman in the Billboard magazine poll. That just thrilled me that my mother was so successful. And when I began singing, I never sang for Mercury Records. But you must have thought you had chart success. You did. You must have thought in the beginning that singing career was what you were going to pursue, or did you think even then, no, I want to go and act?
No, the actual thing that I started doing was boxing. I had a wonderful career. I had 32 fights. I won 29 and I won draw, 2 losses, and I had 20 by knockout. And yeah, the left hook, yeah, it was beautiful. The only problem is I took it out of the gym, hit it, the street, and got it out of lawsuits.
Hey, pretty boy, I'll knock that battery on your shoulder.
I had a French word in response to that.
Yeah, Michael's
favorite. And I said, bullshit. And then the lawsuits came. You know, I've had the opportunity to interview Van Damme and some other people who are action stars, and they say you actually get challenged more. Did you find that the case when you were starring on, we're going to get to Wild Wild West soon, but did you find people picking fights, trying to pick fights with you just to prove their manhood? No. I had idiots that wanted to do that. Same with me, right? Well, if the singing didn't put you on everybody's radar in here, certainly by 1959 you came on the radar when you played a Tomahawk in Hawaiian Eye. And I'm sure there's a lot of fans of that show here today. And you ran from 1959 to 63, and I know you just had on your radio show, which we're going to talk about later, but we're going to introduce your co-star to come out here and talk about Hawaiian Eye with you.
Bobby, you're full of shit.
That's Max Berry.
I was going to say,
Connie,
he has trouble spelling his name.
Yeah, that's true. And I thought Connie's name
was Max Berry. Max, put on some clothes.
Hey, I like you. If you show your abs, I cover my up. All I
got to do. You look cute for a tall guy. Maybe let me finish this interview, please.
We're trying to introduce a class act, Connie Stevens, and Jennifer screwed it up. Come on. Connie Stevens, everyone.
She's from New York, and you know, I knew her parents, and I've known her since I met her at the Academy Awards. I was sitting at this table, and Nick Adams brought me there because he wanted to try and sell a TV series, and he didn't want to be with a woman and leave her alone. So he said, "I want you to go somewhere." And I didn't know what the hell I was going to, and I sat at this table. I looked over there at this little woman, and I thought to myself, And I said, "Hello, little girl. How old are you?" And she said, "I'm 19. And I said, "That works. I'm 22. That'll work." And it was Connie Stevens, and that's how we first met. And I've been in love with her ever since.
Well, I don't know.
I'm going to tell you something right now. This character, in the dark, it was in the days when they used to have dinner tables, came crawling over. "Hey, how you doing? I'm gonna go do a television show at Warner Brothers. Meantime, my boyfriend's going like this." "Who's that under the table?" And I said, "Well, make sure you tell him you wanna be in Hawaiian Eye." And he goes, "Got it." And he's my brother, he's my love, he's been my friend, and something consistent in my life for I don't know how many years it is, but We've watched each other's children grow. We have laughed and cried together, and he's quite a spectacular man.
And I just stayed at her house.
No,
she was in New York, and I was supposed to get into this house building in Malibu, and it wasn't ready. So I called Connie and said, can I sit at your house for a couple of days, which turned into weeks. And she said, sure. And so she was kind enough to let me stay there. And when I heard she was coming back, I left because I didn't, you know, want to crawl into her bed. It's been so many years. Why can't I know? I failed.
For all the girls that work at my house were, Pop Conrad is here. I said, that's right, be careful.
Anyway, the guy that wrote that book that you're looking at now wrote another one called You Never Met a Woman that he didn't like. And of course, Connie's on the front page of it. And it's really an interesting book. And he wrote two others. This is a French author. And he wrote three books on Uncle Bob. I'm really happy. I gave it to the audience to look at. And they're coming through here. And I think, is Connie in the first or second page? Connie Stevens, the one next to him. I don't want to confuse you.
So, one other question they asked, of course, is could either of you have thought that the way I would run as long as it did to be as successful as it would? Did you think you had a head right in the beginning?
I think we were so young, it didn't even matter. We loved what we did. We loved each other. We had so much fun. And we outlasted every show with Warner Brothers.
Yeah.
We were the last one, right, Bobby? And then we were there forever.
And that crossed over to the Sunset Strip, didn't it? And
they should do Sunset Strip.
The camera. Yeah, I'm fine.
Well,
the internet's full.
At least that's what it was.
But then, yeah, they had crossovers, didn't they? With the way the character?
I did. I worked on 77. But we don't make Hawaii a state. We were there before Hawaii was a state. As a matter of fact, I think it was our first or second year. It was so exciting to be a part. And the largest building on the island was the Pink Palace. What's the name of that hotel in Greenwood?
Right? We were at Kaiser. It was Kaiser's.
No, right on the beach.
Kaiser's, and then it became
Royal Hawaiian.
What is it?
Royal
Hawaiian.
I think it was Kaiser, and then it became.
Yeah.
You're losing credibility with me when you.
Yeah. There was a bar there when they put our picture up. Remember that bar, Connie?
Yeah. The show bar.
The show bar. Right. Yeah. Sure. Connie's going and saying, I used to go there and drink.
For both of you, was Hawaii and I the first time you really had the kind of fame where people recognized you on the street?
Oh yeah.
I learned to surf. Thank you, Hawaii.
We were meteorites.
Did you surf, Connie?
A little bit. I didn't date much because these guys followed me around.
That's right, we didn't much of dating.
Did you visit a lot? Have you ever had a place in Hawaii? Did you go back? What do you think of the state after all the time you spent there?
Of all this time, I never bought a place. I should have, but I used to stay in a place called the Colony Surf. Remember the Colony Surf?
It's your interview, don't talk to me.
But I was dating a cute guy there by the name of Kui Lee.
So we did a little Hawaiian slip to the cracks, Bob.
And Bruce Lee was an extra on our show in the first year.
Wow.
And he's a damn good singer. We used to sing all the time. Come on, get that mic. Ready? Sweet someone, whoever you may be.
Sweet someone, you suit me to a team.
Although you pay no attention.
Listen, God, I never liked the song.
That's it.
Opportunity, even though we were lucky enough to have Miss Stevens here once before, you'll be here the rest of the day, correct?
I will.
Downstairs, signing autographs.
I will.
And,
get out of here.
Photographs.
I just had to see my man here.
She did, ladies and gentlemen.
God bless
always
God
talented,
bless
here for Connie Stevens.
don't forget her movie. Quick. Connie Stevens made a movie. And it's going to be released, and it got great reviews, and she wants us to tell you about it. So, do you have that information?
No, but we will.
Connie, what do you want me to say about the movie?
It's on video on demand right now, 100 million homes, Saving Grace B. Jones.
Okay, got it.
Now, if you were actually offered the role of Major Anthony Nelson on I Dream of Jeannie, a lot of people don't know that. Or are you going to say that's not true? Why?
It was what?
You were offered the role of Major Nelson on Jeannie. I Dream of Jeannie.
Oh, yeah, it was.
Yeah. I was wondering if you're just going to continue to screw with me or actually tell them the truth about something.
No. What happened was it was a billing problem.
Yeah, right. They were going to give her star billing.
Yes.
And then it's called Jeannie, and you figure, yeah, this is not a good career. And you were lifelong friends. We all miss Larry Heckman. He's done the Hollywood Show several times. You were lifelong friends with Larry, correct?
Yes.
Yeah. He's a great actor, and it's a shame.
I've never met an actor, frankly, that I didn't like. I love actors and actresses and entertainers. It's a tough business, and those that succeed, I applaud, and those that don't succeed, I applaud. It's a tough business.
You were back in the viewing habits of America soon enough, though, with Wild Wild West. You saw it range from 65 to 69, playing, of course, James West opposite of Ross Martin as Artemis Gordon. I imagine most of us being fans know that you did almost all your stunts in that show.
Kevin. You did almost all your stunts?
Well, would you like me to play the damn clip when you were on the Good Morning America and you said you did 99% of them? I was trying to respect what you said.
Is he all right?
Yeah, no, not really. What I'd like to know is, before Wild Wild West, had you ridden horses yourself?
No.
So you learned for the show?
Yes.
You've talked often about the one horse that did it last the entire series with you?
Superstar.
Yeah, yes.
And I gave that horse to my daughter when she turned 16 as a gift to her, and it was a magnificent horse that did all its own stunts. And I had a stand-in for the horse when they were lighting, because he was such a wonderful performer. I would let him stand there. I took him off and he had an extra horse standing for a Superstar. Magnificent animal. If you see the clips or see the show and you see the stunts we do it together, and it was very exciting for me to be on the same page with him.
It's also been said, I'm sure it's true, they built a boxing ring on the set for you to work out in, correct?
Yes, they did. They built a boxing ring.
One of the questions your fans here today asked was, what was your regime then or now? You know, any physical regime to stay in shape that you would do daily?
Well, then I was training to turn professional as a boxer, and I was going to fight in Tokyo. And prior to that, I was going to do exhibitions with Emil Griffith, who at that time was middleweight champion of the world, and we were going to do exhibitions for the Vietnam veteran soldiers, and we were going to do them for the soldiers. But he lost his title to an Italian, and I did a stunt on the Wild West, and I had a 6-inch lingual fraction of the high temple fracture, and that ended in my opportunity for a year to turn pro. And with Emil out of it and me after waiting a year, I boarded the opportunity to turn pro and fight in Tokyo.
You fell about 20 feet to the concrete when another stuntman, I think you've said, wasn't there when you did the aerial part of that stunt.
It was late. It was late, not once but twice.
Wow.
I wasn't happy with it then, I'm not happy with it now.
I've heard you say before that Ross Martin, who didn't do much of his stunts, did a lot of them. I mean, you set the tone on that show, so a lot of people, even Michael Dunn, you said, liked to try to do stunts. And is it true you said most people got injured?
Michael had to do his own stunts because he was 3 feet. who's gonna double that? I could get on my knees, maybe. And Ross did some of the stunts. Some, you know.
He'd said before that he'd hurt himself, but I'm sure he was trying to.
Yeah, he broke his leg. But Ross was being interviewed on the Johnny Carson show, and Johnny wasn't a fan of mine. I'll tell you a story about that. It was kind of interesting. But Johnny said, so now, do you do your own stunts? And Ross said, no, I do my own acting. Yes, Mr. Martin. And I saw him and I said, you son of a bitch.
Another fan wanted to know, did the guns that were used so much ever spook your horses?
No.
No, so the blank firing they were used
no,
to?
No, but the thing with I don't know if I'm going to go there. Go ahead, I will go there, but I'll go there later.
Oh, okay. Were you ever thrown from a horse?
Yes.
But the worst injury was the aerial, over the balcony one that put you 6-9 months in rehabilitation, didn't it, or in the hospital?
Six months.
6 months, good Lord, that's incredible. And by the way, y'all should know this, if you don't, of course, Mr. Conrad is in the Stuntman's Hall of Fame, as well as the show. Aside, you can count on one hand the actors that are in there, so it's quite an achievement. I mean, it's...
No, there aren't any actors in there.
Yeah, that's what I said on one hand. Robert Conrad.
I'm the only one.
That's it.
Now, to Johnny Carson fans, I don't mean to offend you. I just want to share this with you. John was married to one of the wives, and they were arguing, and she later had a short-lived TV series, so if you remember her, that's who she was. And they're arguing, and it comes on, but Uncle Bob, and she points to the TV and says, now that is a real man. And that was the NYA Johnny Carson show. Thank you, Johnny Carson. Oh, well, hopefully.
There were so many great actors, though, that you had the pleasure to, I mean, that went through Wild Wild West. It was such a popular show. Was that why you were able to cast so many fantastic actors at the time through there?
Yeah, they wanted to do the show. We had Ida Lupino, who I admired, who was one of the first female directors. She did the show. Yeah, we had celebrated people.
A lot of people seem to ask a lot. I love Victor Buono, and I met him before he passed. I never met Michael Dunn. A lot of people in the audience have asked various questions about him. So rather than ask him specifically, what is your remembrance of that actor, Michael Dunn, who played, of course, Meekly to Loveless? Did you enjoy working with him?
With Michael?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I was just trying to remember something that was specific, but no, I enjoyed working with him.
There was an interview you did a few years ago where they showed a clip on a new show of a scene where he was to go down in a boat in a lake, and I guess he did that too, and you were saying that it was hilarious that he did try again to do all his own stunts, and even that one, they about drowned him trying to go down in the water on that. But like you said, at 3'8", it wouldn't be hard to drown somebody like that. But a lot of people in the audience asked about him and Victor Buono. Did you have any memories of working with him?
No, not working with him. I had a memory of him outside the China Trader restaurant in Burbank.
Well, tell us. Where are your friends? They won't go any farther.
Well, I know what the statute of limitations is. We had a dispute during the filming of the pilot, and Dick Buono was in it. We got into the parking lot, and this guy made an unnecessary, arrogant remark. And he paid the price right here. Short to the chin. Lawsuit. Anyway, no, he didn't see it. Thank goodness he didn't see it.
There are a lot of reoccurring villains on there. We are thrilled to have one with us today as part of the James Bond reunion downstairs. If you please welcome to the stage, Richard Kiel. Your memories of this man on stage here. He's talking about everybody else. We want to hear what you think about him.
What? He's a shy. Did you bring him?
Everybody remembers him on Wild Wild West. request, Mr. Rich, I call him. Fantastic. What mention was your memories of Michael Dunn, since you worked obviously a lot of scenes with him?
Who are you talking to?
To Richard. About Michael Dunn.
It was my show.
Okay. What was your memories of Richard's memories of Michael Dunn?
Forget about Michael Dunn. Talk about him. I remember him throwing me down a flight of stairs.
And I'll never forgive him. Nobody could double for you either, could they?
Yeah, but you know, he beat me up so much I ended up like this. Hall of Fame, so, you know, my memories of Bob was that he was a very, very dedicated actor who wanted his own rights to entertain people. And he didn't mind me when I tried seeing a few scenes here and there. I think he kind of applauded it. And as a really, you know, nice guy, one of the few real gentlemen, many men that I've worked with, along with Roger Miller and a couple of others. Is that too?
Thank you for that, man. I appreciate it. And you and working with Michael was one of the joys of doing the show. I mean,
well, that first show that Michael Dunn and I did together on the Royal Ross, I think they took 8 days to film. Bernie Kowalski directed it. It was shot like a little movie. All the TLC. It really helped my career. You know, because it let me act a little bit.
Yeah, with all the big stars. I forgive you for it.
Okay. Well, you know, it's funny because I first wrote a verse in a TV show called Life of It. And you know, my agent had said, if they ever ask you if you can write a verse, say, oh, yeah, you know, because usually all you have to do is to write up, get off and turn the verse up to the hitching post, and that's about it. And you know, so I made the mistake of saying, oh, yeah, it's practically boring the verse. And so I get out to the location, and they say, okay, that hill up there, that tree up there, you go up that hill around that tree, and you and Kevin Hagan come riding around that tree, and then down the hill as fast as you can. And you bring up the rifleman and so, and oh my God, I was actually terrified. So I said to the Wranglers, I said, you know, I don't have too much of a horse, but you think I can ride the horse around a little bit? And they said, yeah, my hat flew off. And then he said, you're going to need somebody to pin that hat on. If you don't have to do it more than once. Anyway, Kevin's horse went zooming down that hill. My horse just took right out after. And if you ever see the show, there's a big tall guy with his eyes closed. But later on, when I had some children, we had three horses.
You were, like Connie, that show, you were probably more recognized by people after that show in the beginning, right? Even though you had done Life of Me and you'd done, I know, a lot of other things.
Oh, yeah, I mean, the Wild Wild West was much bigger for me than Life of Me. And I did four of them, and right. Three with Michael Larry Manetti. And it was a great opportunity to learn and to act and be in a show that was very, very popular.
And they asked me, the audience said, what's it like working with him? I said, how the hell do I know? I never saw him. He's so goddamn tall.
Well, I didn't know you were such a comedian.
Neither did I.
Not either, you know. I'm sit down for a stand up for a bit.
I don't live there, so I don't get to hear him show up in the clubs.
You can hear
him. You can hear his podcast, too. Yeah, that's what you
thought. Also, Roger was having a present with me. I just got an ad from Kindle Fire that allows you to tune in to different radio stations. So hopefully that was
it. No, I can get it. I want you to do the show. Alita, get the information from us. The show is the number one international show. It has 12 million listeners.
Oh, my goodness.
Yes,
and that's great.
Yeah, and I want you to do it.
You've got a great sense of humor.
Would you do the show?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
It's fantastic. In addition to everything else we're seeing today, you just saw Robert Conrad networking. I think it's fantastic. Everybody, you got to go downstairs and see Richard while he's here today and tomorrow, right? You're going to be able to see him
tomorrow.
He's been here before, but he's with the Bond reunion, of course, and I know we've taken you away from the line of fans. You've got to go down there and support him and get some autographs and photographs. Richard, Kiel, everybody. This rascal was back on our television sets with Baba Black Sheep, which after syndication, they changed the name to Black Sheep Squad. They went in from 76 to 78.
What?
And it did.
What are you talking about, Black Sheep?
Black Sheep, yeah.
Let's talk about Wild West for a minute.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay, what happened to Wild West, for those of you that liked the show, I didn't like it, I loved it, was it was canceled for TV violence by women against violence on television.
And still at the top of the ratings.
Well, now it's on at 4 o'clock on some station.
MeTV!
What was that again?
MeTV!
MeTV! It's on MeTV, and it is number one syndicated radio, television show, which thrills me. I've watched it several times. My former driver, Tim Kelly is his name, lives in a mobile facility, and waiting for the house to get built, I've spent some time staying at his home in his trailer, and he watches the show and he showed it to me. That's the first time I got an opportunity to see it after all the years. I'm like, God damn, it's a good show.
Fantastic. It holds up. It holds up brilliantly. In the 80s, it was number one in Australia. They were playing it in prime time.
Well, I'm talking about France now. France has been just unbelievable to me, and I can't thank those French people enough. Well, I will in July when I go back just to thank them. But what we do now is we go to the Black Sheep Squad, and where you're going, which got canceled, for Women Against Violence on television. So I'd like to get around to the bitches and slap them.
Well, of course, we know you played a real-life leader of that squadron who wrote a book about his exploits that caused the show to come about, Pappy Boeington, and of course he was a technical advisor, you worked with him on the set, a great man. What I wonder is, and the audience had this question, it came up a lot, is the first time you played, or I don't know if it was, but the point is you were playing someone that was a real-life person instead of a character. How much of that was Pappy and how much was Robert?
It was as much as Pappy wanted it, you know. He was there every day, he sat in the trailer, and I supplied the vodka, and and it was a wonderful experience to me. He was awarded the Congressional Medal of Honor. He was incarcerated in prison in Japan and shot down, and we became not good friends, but sort of best friends, and he was playing a golf tournament up north in Northern California, and I became a pilot, bought my own airplane, and I would fly in the second season to work, and all the cast, we go, look at that son of a bitch, he's buying it. That's right. And in any event, so Colonel Boynton said, I'd like to fly it up there. And I said, oh, okay, Colonel, I mean, he's in his 80s, now what are you going to say no to the Congressional Medal of Honor Award? And we're flying, and all of a sudden it's time to land, and we call, and the towers says, all right, this is the instructions. And I see we're not following those instructions. And we hit a fence.
Conrad, come up to the tower.
So I said, all right. So I took Colonel Boynton. We went up the tower, and I said, this guy was flying. I said, oh my God, Colonel, how are you doing? So forget about it, Bob. Everything's okay.
For those of you who don't know, they used real Defense Department footage for aerial dogfights, and they also used some new footage that was shot using antique planes from a group that called themselves the Confederate Air Force. I don't know if it was true, but it was said many times that later they stopped shooting because they were worried about losing those crafts. Now those beautiful planes are priceless, many of them, the ones that they used and that they still own, and most of them are in museums. What some of your fans wanted to know was, they knew you had flown, you flew to the set, like you mentioned. Did you get a chance to ever fly yourself in one of the big wing Corsairs?
No, I was going to, I was training. And when the show got canceled, I boarded the train and said, what the hell's a I shall learn to fly a Corsair, there's no point, the show's over. So no, I never had an opportunity, but I would have been flying it to work if the show lasted.
Well, comes in a Corsair, that son of a bitch.
Well, we've got a co-star. There were a lot of people who won the big TV careers out of that group of guys. One of them is still a friend of yours. And again, we're thrilled to have you at the show as part of the Magnum PI reunion. New friend, everybody, Larry Manetti. Yeah! Show. That was a unique show, wasn't it? There's nothing that's been done like that since.
Forget about that. I met Larry Manetti. He's from Chicago.
Yeah.
And,
well, let me tell the story.
No, wait a minute. I get a phone call from Chicago, and the guy says, you know, he's obviously one of us. I said, he's one of us. So I go to this great restaurant. I can't remember the name of it, but it's where all the celebrities went back in the day. And went with Larry, we chatted. So I get an opportunity to do a picture in the Philippines, and I want to put him in the picture. And the guy who ran it, then he passed away. You know, he died.
John Ashley?
No, not John. What was the name of the producer?
Romero?
No, the guy from Texas.
Oh, Carruthburg.
Yeah, Carruthburg. So I went up to Carruth and I said, "Yeah, you got to put him in this part." He said, "No, I can't." I said, "What do you mean you can't?" He said, "I can't. He's not in the Screen Actors Guild. Nothing. I can't do it." I said, "I'll tell you what, I'll pay him for my per diem," which per diem is what they give you in the show business to buy your lunches and kind of live outside of your salary. So he said, "Well, if you want to do that, it's okay with me." So Larry comes over and he's doing a wonderful job in the show. And one night I go up to visit my daughters. I hear kind of a noise. And I go, "What the hell is that noise?" I said, "Pull those drapes." And sitting in a goddamn tree is Larry Manetti.
Trio.
All right, tell your story now.
So question. I'm in the treehouse with his daughter, Joan, unbeknownst to him, but it wasn't like I had set up a relationship with his daughter. There was nowhere for me to sleep, and we were in the middle of a jungle with panthers and monkeys walking around. And here I am in this treehouse, and I said, "Duke. Yo, Duke," and he's looking around, and I see a light, and I say, "It's me." He says, "Manetti, what are you doing in the, what's she doing there?" I said, "I'm gonna get killed." And the only way down was on these little steps, and I tried to make it, and I did, but luckily, he didn't bring me, but he looked at Joan, and she says, "Dad, go back to bed."
Daddy, look at the damn audience.
I'm looking at you because I'm looking at
they came here, they paid some money.
I told them, you are. And also, I'm very happy that Duke is here. I know this is the first time he's ever done this.
But you know, Manetti, they sold out, but those people didn't show. So maybe we can do a deal on their tickets. Why not?
Did you fly at all? Did you have any phone? Did you have a pilot's license? Or?
You mean from bars?
Well, hang on, wait. This guy from Chicago, I'm sure.
No, I didn't fly.
We got into a great war. We got into one of the great wars at that, what was the name of that?
That candy store.
The candy store. It was a very in place. If you were an actor, you just wanted to go to the candy store. So Lawrence and I are in the candy store. And Lawrence, she says, "Honey, yes." And he invites her to dance, and they're out there dancing. It was an L-shaped bar. Next to me is this big, muscular black guy, and over here in the center is some kind of overweight Italians that I didn't know were from Chicago at that time. I found out later. So anyway, they're there, and Larry comes back, and the guy says, "What are you doing? Don't do that again. Don't ask her to dance." Now, her husband had just died. And it was a good thing, therapeutic for her to have some companionship. And I said to the guy, I said, "Hey, wait a minute, back off. If he wants to dance with her, it's up to her to say no." And the black guy says, "Hey, don't talk to him like that." I said, "Who are you?" He says, "I'm with him." I said, Oh, that's interesting.
Bang!
So it's not like he's on an elevator. And the next thing I know, I'm on the floor. And I'm getting booted, kicking.
And
he lies on top of me to stop him. He gets booted. And so they start kicking the shit out of him.
Yeah,
well, story, Manetti.
You forgot to mention this big black guy turned out to be the champion of the world. And,
not that night.
Well, we made it out, and we got into, I had a white Cadillac Eldorado convertible then, and we got in, and I was all messed up, and Duke said, all right, let's go. And I said, I got to go to a hospital. He said, well, find him. So I'm driving, and I couldn't see, and I'm going through stoplights, and this cop pulls us over. And he looks in the window, and I'm a mass of blood. And he goes, oh, my God. And he says, hey, it's me. And the guy goes, oh, my God, it's Robert Conrad. Where do you guys want to go? We'll escort you. And I thought we were going to take you to the nearest bar, but we did make it to the hospital.
He forgets to tell you, if we pull over to one of those old-fashioned telephone things, you know, booths where the phone's there.
Oh,
all right, so I'm going to call and find out what the closest hospital is. And I'm, what the hell is going on? What the hell is going on? And Larry says, well, maybe it's because that thing is hanging there.
Yeah, it was cut off.
It was cut off. It wasn't plugged in, but I'm trying to call it not plugged in. Or it was a lot of fun.
One of the many adventures.
Yes. Now, the next day, or 2 days later, I got a friend in Chicago whom I love, absolutely love. He was like my relationship, like blood. And his brother comes from Las Vegas. This guy comes from Chicago. And I walk into this upscale Italian restaurant, and who's sitting there but the fat guys that were there two nights before kicking the shit out of Larry and me. And Tony says, what do you want to do? I said, I'll take an apology. He said, give him one. And I got one.
You know, you can tell this gentleman on the stage, no one else could have done the Ever Ready commercials that he started doing around that time. Everybody remembers those, daring them to knock it off. How did that come about, Robert, when they came to you with that script?
So the name of the book is, what do we call it? Duke of 63rd Street?
Yeah.
Is that the title? Okay. Anyway, the name of this book is going to be The Duke of 63rd Street, and I'm going to tell my life story from the beginning, and what you just heard will be in there. I'm only going to delete some things that I don't think are appropriate for me to mention because there are other people, and without their permission, and some of them have passed away, I'm not going to go there. This is just our stuff, and the Larry Manetti story will definitely be in there.
There's more! Now, the Ever Ready commercials were incredible. I mean, they're in the Commercial Hall of Fame, those commercials, as you know. Did you think they would be as popular as they were when you first shot one?
No, I saw the payday. And I said, I'm going to do this. And I did, and I got the payday shot. And then I had 2 hours, 2 days, I'm sorry, 2 years left. And I asked Ever Ready if they'd be kind enough to get me out of my contract. And they said, yeah, if you guarantee us you won't do another commercial for 2 years. And I said, I guarantee that. And the reason I asked them to release me was because it was redundant. It was the same thing.
Right.
And I had done it for 3 years, and I didn't want to do it for five. So, and it was a wonderful experience. The Ever Ready Company was a great company to work for. And it was fun walking around going, I dare you. You've got to be goofy to walk around to American men and go, I dare you. They're going to line up. And the only time it worked, and it was, I was flying into Chicago, and I had a little trouble with the landing, and there was some conversation with the tower. And anyway, I got out of the airplane, and this guy says to me, I'll knock it off. And I turned around and I said, you ain't gonna do shit. End of story. No left hook, no straight right hand. It was just, I was offended. And so, oh, poor guy's offended.
By 1979, we're back again with a man called Sloan. Oh, wait, there's your number one fan back there with that show. The press dubbed it, though, James West in another setting. I thought it was fantastic, so did he, and so did they.
Ronald Larry Manetti, I wanted to talk about
that. Well, I figured it here.
And we asked Larry Manetti if he was staying
for 80 years with that big tall guy.
Yeah, well, he was in a little show that made it about a decade, too, Bob. That's why he's down there signing for Magnum P.I., but this is
about James. It's wonderful. Magnum P.I., and then what else? He's just had a wonderful career, but it started with him in a tree.
That's true. But what you are not telling everybody, and I'm going to tell them, is I was in Chicago, and I had met Bob, and he said, if you want to come out here and try to be in show business, call me. So I did, and he answered the phone. It was on Wild West, and I said, I'm ready. Ready for what? I said, you know, I'm ready to come out there. He says, well, come on, get your ass out here, Manetti. I'm going to Vienna. I'll give you the keys to my apartment. I'll be gone for 3 months. Just keep it clean and make sure when I come back, there's no beer cans and crap laying around, and I'll take care of you. Guess what? He did.
Thank you. That's the end, Larry. You're done.
Thank
you. Thank you. Thank you. We have one of your fans that asked a question about Centennial. They said you were fantastic in it, and you were. They said you should have received the Emmy, and I agree, that was fantastic work.
Well,
they
wanted to... Wait. Kevin, yeah. Every actor wants a body of work. Every actor wants to look back at his career, and they say, what was that moment? And in my career, I've got a new TV show I'm going to be doing in March, but I mean, I don't want to talk about that. It's, anyway, the moment in my career was Centennial. That was my best work. And I want you to see La Nueva Cinecienta because of the flamenco dancing and the Spanish singing. It's classic, and you people know film. I can tell from the response that you know film. Get that with Marisol. And then the first 5 hours of Centennial is my best work. And I had to jump into a body of water, and it was freezing. And they were trying to figure out how to make it work without freezing the actor. I said, forget about it. I got so much emotional stuff going on, I will jump into that water. I said, all right, so I did it. And I came out and I was absolutely freezing. There's a hand on my shoulder. And the guy said, you are Pasquinel, which is the character I played. And he said, you are Pasquinel. And I turned around and said, who are you? And he said, I'm James Michener. And I have a letter from him on the book that he sent me that I cherish. And when I get into my new home, I'll take it out and frame it somewhere, because it was a challenge to do that. And it was acting at its highest level, and I'm thrilled I had the opportunity to do it. So if you want to see what he thinks is his best work, that's it.
Wow, fantastic. Wow. Another person in the audience tonight, Robert, wanted to know who's the most challenging. You've had the most beautiful leading ladies and co-stars of probably anybody's career. Who was the most challenging of them to work with, and who was your favorite to work with?
My favorite actress?
Yeah.
Oh, everyone I worked with. Are you kidding me?
Well, that's Dish. Who was the most challenging?
No, hello. Hey, baby, what's up? No, the book is unbelievable. It's called I Never Met a Woman I Didn't Like. And that's the truth. It comes from Mom. You know, my dad wasn't close to me, really. We had moments. But then there was a fallout. So anyway, but I was very, very close to my mother. And she would say, you know what you didn't do? And she'd
either punch me in the butt or slap me in the face. And I said, oh God, what did I do? You didn't open the door for that woman. I went, okay, Mom. You didn't stand up when she walked in the room. Okay, Mom, you didn't open the door when she got in the car. I learned to do that. How are you doing? I wouldn't like you. I'm sorry. Well, that's all I grew up in. Respect for women. And I do that. So you asked me what women, yeah. They were all. Are you kidding me? I was lucky to work with those women for 104 episodes.
Wow.
Yeah, well, I was right.
And Mom set the tone for that. We have another question from the audience. What was the most unusual job in or out of show business that you ever had?
Probably working on the docks, probably. You know, yeah. You know, I loaded trucks until on the midnight shift, midnight till 8:30. And then I saw this Teamster guy driving this thing. And I said to myself, what do you think I'm going to do with that instead of loading these trucks? So I graduated into driving a Heister.
Right.
Okay, and I would pick up the pallets. And they would drop them off, and these stupid guys would load the trucks. And I was no longer one of those stupid guys. So yeah, that was a tough job.
This is another Marshall 710 Teamsters.
One. I ran for office and wanted to be, at that time, I wanted to be a Teamster, and I wanted to be a union guy at that time.
Well, since you said that, I'll skip this question for a minute, because you were mayor up near where you live, correct, for many years?
No, I wasn't
mayor. You weren't mayor. No. So, do people just make shit up online about you?
I have no idea. I was a deputy sheriff.
Deputy sheriff. 8 years, right?
Reserve deputy sheriff, yeah. Is there anything else that we know that was, no?
King of the world.
Did you, king of the world. Did you like that? Did you like I can't see you liking politics.
Well, I like politics.
Do you?
Yeah, I like politics. I don't like it recently, because now that I do a radio show, I have listeners that are of different persuasion.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want to alienate that audience, because it's an audience, and I respect their opinion. So you can be anything, and I won't challenge it.
They respect your opinion, and as your fans, and one of them wanted to know what your opinion was of reality shows that are all over the place now. They want to know, not me, I don't know the question. They want to know what you thought of reality shows. Do you even watch it? Do you watch much television yourself?
Alita, what do I think of reality shows?
Meh.
Meh. God, Alita's not my lover, she's my assistant.
You keep saying that.
Boyfriend, right? Boyfriend of gay.
Do you watch anything yourself? Do you watch any shows at all today?
Yes.
Yeah, do you have a favorite?
Yes.
Which one?
It's called The Five. It's on Fox.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah. Fox and it's five people, and they're very funny. Bob, the one that's the staunch Democrat, is hilarious. And the women are all pretty, and they show their legs.
I have a question.
Women are high heels, which I love even more.
What? I have a question for you. Again, maybe this was missaid in an interview once, but once in an interview you said you got by on very little sleep, an average 4 hours a night. Was that true only at one time, or is that still true today?
What was the question?
That you got by on very little sleep. You said you average sometimes only 4 or 5 hours a night sleep.
Would you open that coffee for me?
Oh, sir. That'll answer the question. Or were you talking about, was that
back
a certain
then,
time?
Back, yeah. Back in the day, yeah, I could do 4 hours, and I would think. And I would do four, or I would do six. But now that I'm older, I need to sleep, and I enjoy my sleep now. So I do maybe eight.
Right.
And that depends. Sometimes I might do a little more.
Now, we all know you've got your own radio show.
What's the what?
We all know you've got your own radio show. I've heard it many times. How many people have heard about the radio show? Fantastic.
Thank you.
And as we said earlier, if you can't for any reason tune in, there's a way to see it, hear it free on podcast. And on publicshow.com, they're going to post all that information for you. You've been there 4 years now, is that right?
Yes, 4 years.
What do you think about that? I mean, that's brand new. You've never done radio before.
Well, I have a TV show. That I'm going to be doing a television series. And I just got the news that I was chosen to be the star of the show, and I didn't.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And I didn't pursue with my agent. I don't know why. Alita, why didn't I pursue it? What's her first name?
Cheryl.
Thank you. That would be the first thing to go. 29 wins, 32 fights. Stanley Wozinski, I lost. That was the eighth fight. And the last fight was Johnny Lepkin. And he was going to be in our Olympics, and unfortunately, he was taken by an airplane crash. Great fighter, and we got standing ovation, and when he was chosen, I wasn't disappointed because I knew one of us was going to be chosen, and it was John, and John with me. So I'm doing an interview for a TV movie, because he and I primarily do television, TV movies for television, and, which I enjoy more than the other. And anyway, I'm publicizing this thing, and I walk out, and this kid at the front said, "Hi, Mr. Carreer, how are you doing?" "It's good. I liked your interview." "So thanks." He said, "My father beat you in the ring." I said, "What?" He said, "My father beat you in the ring." I said, "I know your father's old." I said, "What's his name?" He said, "His name is Johnny Lepkin." I said, "Your father did beat me in the ring." He said, "Mr. Conrad, he married an Italian woman. Every Sunday we had a big brunch. And what would be fun is if you could come to that brunch and say hi to my dad. And say, what would be more fun is if I come to the brunch, but you don't tell him. And I knock on the door." And he said, "Would you do that?" I said, "Yeah." So he lived in the suburb outside of, not Miami, but that went go up north. Fort Lauderdale. Mm-hmm. And so I got there on time, and I knocked on the door, and I banged hard on the door, and I heard this gruff voice, "What the hell, who is it? He opens the door, and he sees me, and he said, "Oh my God," and I said, "And I want a rematch." And we sat and we talked about that little fight for weeks. It didn't last that long, but it did with us. And then, remember when I hit you with the other shoe? I remember that. Which, of course, I did.
I know there's no better news for anyone in this room than hear you returning to television in March, and I'm sure you'll be able to mention that on your radio show.
Oh, sure I will.
On your website, and keep everyone posted so we know.
I wonder how that's going to affect the radio show. I haven't thought about that. Oh, well, we'll see.
And again, all the radio show information, because a lot of people have asked about it that didn't know, is going to be on the Hollywood Show website, and we've got information downstairs. And all these people are excited about to the fact that you graciously decided to take pictures next with them, which we're going to do over here, so if you want to just stay seated. And all this love you're about to hear, including from me, is for you.
Wait a minute, where are we going to do it?
We're going to do the pictures right over there. They're going to set up right over here.
Why over there? Why don't we do them right here?
We'll ask the photographer, but if everybody stays seated, they're going to call you one at a time.
We can do that, but let's do the A's first, the questions. Let's do the questions first, and then
Are there any other questions? The questions were asked through my
back there, furthest away, yes.
Would you compare Michael Dunn's character, Dr. Miguelito Loveless, to Frank Borshin's character, the Riddler on Batman?
No, I thought he was... No, that's like a different character. Sure.
Can I do my Hulk Hogan voice as a tribute to you?
Sure, go ahead.
But what you gonna do when James West, Barry Boynton, and Hulkamania, and the man called Sloan, runs wild, rumbles, and destroys you?
Too loud. Yes.
Well, that's a nice segue for my next question.
Go. Yes.
That I just loved you with.
I loved it too, and I won most of them. And the actor John Mancini hated me.
From Rome. Yes, sir.
Yes, I was just wondering if you had any formal karate training before Wild Wild West.
Yeah, I had it before Hawaii and I. And we call it kara, which is empty tay, which is hand, defending yourself with your empty hand. And I saw a lot of actors getting awards for their physical prowess, and it offended me because I knew they couldn't spell karate. So the first season of Wild West in the boxing sequences I did karate, and then I saw this, and I said, oh, we'll go back to what I know better, which was street fighting. I took it out of the ring and put it in the street and so on and so forth. Yes, sir.
Thanks for coming, first of all.
It's a pleasure.
Great to see you. And two questions. One, what was your favorite episode of Wild Wild West? Which was the one that you had the most fun with?
All of them.
And which was the favorite episode you did with Ross Martin?
All of them.
All of them.
Every day coming to work was a thrill for me. I enjoyed it. And the first time that I was on a horse, we were doing the pilot, and Wrangler, which is the guy that takes care of the horses, came up to the director and said, well, you know something? You're going to love this because you're going to see a lot of the scenery because his ass is so far away from the saddle. All you see is all the background because this guy can't even spell horse. Which is true, but I there were two guys in the acting business that got accolades. One was Glenn Ford and the other was Conrad Paul. Yes, sir.
My question is with Wild Wild West, was there ever a thought about actually doing a theatrical movie?
They did one. And by the way, you were one of the only actors to have the balls to accept a Razzie Award in person. That was hilarious. That movie was, I think we all agree, so bad with Will Smith. And this man showed up at the Razzie Awards, which is for worst film, and accepted three of the damn awards in person. Will Smith, he lives in Westlake Village, and at that time I lived there, and I'm going to the restaurant, he's coming out with his beautiful wife, and we look at each other and we'd stop, and he said, well, it was an interpretation. I said, is that what it was? I knew it was something. And his wife said, I told you so, I told you so. Yes, sir.
Did you enjoy playing roles for villains like on Mission Impossible?
Yeah, I like to. You know, I like to act. I mean, I'll play anything because it's so much fun, and you're so lucky to do it. And if you do it well, you can entertain your audience, and that's what it's all about. You know, it's all about you and giving you the best you can give. That's what it is, and that's what I like to do. You played a great bad guy in Columbo.
Yeah.
Everybody remember that?
Yeah.
It was fantastic, too. That's another thing. So the star of Columbo, unfortunately, just passed away.
Right. Peter Falk.
Yeah, I know. And thank you for sharing that. Anyway, so Peter Falk. In the sequence, I'm supposed to drink this orange juice, and I'm drinking carrot juice instead, and I said, I can't stand this damn carrot juice. I want to go back to the orange juice. And Peter said, no, it's more real if you drink the carrot juice because of your reaction. And I said, "Where shit. But I did what he said and drank the goddamn carrot juice.
Mr. Conrad, I've been a fan since I was a kid, and you're one of my heroes. I also met Pappy Boyington 6 months before he died, and he looked like a bulldog marine even in his last 6 months. How was it to be portraying a living legend? And what was you made two episodes with him face to face. Which one was your favorite?
Well, my favorite was, first of all, being chosen and to do the role. And everything I did with Pappy was my favorite. But I went on an interview with a friend of mine who just passed away, a wonderful producer, director. I went into his office to be interviewed for the part. And Colonel Boynton Gray was sitting there. And we chatted, and then the producer said, would you step outside for a few moments? I said, sure. So I went and stepped outside. And, you know, I had done Wild West, and I was kind of iffy about why am I, you know. But anyway, I went and stepped outside. You know who I'm talking about the producer?
Stephen
Cannell. Yeah, Stephen Cannell. Yeah. Who was a magnificent guy. and another one of my best friends. But the two guys that Larry Manetti and I talked about, they came from Vegas, one from Chicago. They did a horrible film about them, allegedly. And I lost respect for the director after they did that film because it had no credibility. And they were buried alive outside of in Indiana. And then they did this movie, and what was the name of that movie?
Casino,
yeah. Terrible. I wouldn't see it. What was the director's name?
Martin Scorsese.
Yes, and I loved him. But after he did that, you're obligated to do the research on the person you are playing or directing. And when I did Greg Boynton, he was there. And if he said, no, don't do that, I wouldn't do it. And then I played another guy who was in jail for a while. But he was in Washington, big shot. What was his name?
G. Gordon Liddy.
So I played G. Gordon Liddy, and Gordon was there. He was there for everything I did. And so I said to myself, that's what you do. That's what you're obligated to do. Play the person you're playing. And when Will Smith played me, it was... I just can't. It was a horrible experience. He should have done it a little differently. All right. So what was the other question?
The two episodes that the Colonel played in your show, you had two scenes with him. What was your favorite of those two episodes, facing, living, portraying him while you're facing him?
What happened was, so I'm with Stephen Campbell. I'm waiting outside. Colonel Boynton comes out and says, hey, let's go have a drink and celebrate. You got the role. And I said, well, Colonel, that's wonderful. So we went to the Hilton Hotel, which is right by the Universal Studios. And it was so joyous having this opportunity that we both stayed there overnight. We couldn't get out of there. We just couldn't fly, couldn't walk, couldn't drive.
Is that in the book?
Yeah, that will definitely be in the book. The only thing that won't be in the book are the names of... I want to ask you a question, because like I say, this was sold out, some people didn't show, that's fine, but I'm glad the ones that did show are here. But in the book, I want to be very careful to protect so many people. I will tell the story about the two brothers who were murdered. Because Michael, the youngest brother, was the best friend I've ever had. He was blood to me, and I love him that much. So, in the book, I wanted to leave the names of the women that I've had the pleasure of their company. What the hell are you having that? You're a woman. But in any event, there's one woman who is absolutely famous. And Natalie Wood had a party that Sinatra threw for her 21st birthday. And I was invited to go there. And it was partners, and my wife was never a fan of my first wife, who died of ovarian cancer, Joan. She never was a fan of show business. And that was one of the problems we had. She didn't care about show business. Her father was a very successful lawyer who retired at 42, and he was absolutely brilliant and very rich. So I took her out of the suburbs to Hollywood, and it just didn't work. But so I'm with Jack Warner. I'm one of the few actors that really admired and respected Colonel Warner of Warner Brothers. And we're buddies. And I said, is that suit? Did you get that suit? Sign of war? And he said, yeah. I said, well, guess what? I got mine there, thanks to you. From Sight of War. He's like, because I paid you too much. That was Jack Warner. So anyway, that's the party for Natalie. And then I get a phone call from an actor. And he said, I'd like you to come to the house for dinner, but don't bring your wife. I said, huh, what? He said, no, it's card games, guys. I said, all right, I can deal with that. Can't my wife come and talk to your wife? He said, no. I said, okay. So I go, and there's just the two of them, and he had this guy that was his arm cooked and everything for him. He was just available to this guy all the time, this actor. His wife was an actress, too. So I look around, there's no one there but the three of us. What the hell's going on? And in comes this actress. And I took a deep breath, and I went, oh, my God. He leaned over to me and he said, that's what she wants for her birthday. You. So, I told him the story. But I don't want her to be named in the book. She's passed away. I think it would be inappropriate. But I can tell the story the way I just told her.
Believe that.
Yeah, sure, of course, okay?
We got time for two more questions? Yes.
There won't be any.
The young lady in the second row?
Yes. Yes. Oh, yes, lady in the second row.
Hi, how are you?
I'm fair, how are you?
Good. My sister and I grew up watching all your sitcoms and movies, so I'm your biggest fan. And I'm just curious to know that, what your favorite role was that you played in all your sitcoms and movies?
Centennial.
Oh,
you weren't listening. But you're pretty enough not to have to listen.
Yes, sir, with a long black hair, yeah.
What's your favorite Wild Wild West gadget and your least favorite Wild Wild West gadget?
What? I was staring at the woman. You're talking about gadgets?
Yes. Yeah.
Your favorite and your least favorite. My favorite gadget was my payday. And my least favorite was when it got canceled because of violence on television. Which is the same reason they canceled follow-up, actually. So I got tired of getting canceled.
And this gentleman said, did you ever keep any props from the show?
Yes, I did. As a matter of fact, I got a phone call, and they said, this man in Florida, what's the name of that city? It'll come to me. But wants to buy the train from the Wild West.
The Wanderer.
And I said, Ian, I'm not in charge of that. He said, but he wants you to come down and pose with his two sons. And I said, and what? And he said, it's a payday for you. It's a significant payday for you. And I said, let's talk payday. You know, it was a Teamster. Come on. And okay, I said, that seems to work for me. Wow. And I went and met this guy and his two sons, and there was the train on his property. And I walked up to the second floor, when you see the view from the second floor. As I'm walking down, I see this magnificent picture of this woman. I mean, absolutely brilliant. And he said, that's my wife, and she passed away. And I wanted to do this for my boys, because she was in her late 20s. And he said, I'm still in love with her. I said, all right. So anyway, I posed with the boys, and it was an interesting experience for the Wild West. That's probably the most significant thing that happened to me in the time I did that show.
You should put that in the book as well. That's fantastic.
I will put that in the book. I can't remember this. Do you remember this? Yeah. Okay, so, Alita, you're not with it tonight. Are you thinking about Rory?
Rory, one more question.
He's the dwarf, she goes.
Third girl right here trying to get ready.
Yeah,
last question. That's
good. I just wanted to ask Bob, are you aware that they've just released on a CD all your old recordings from Warner Brothers, all your singles? It's come out on a CD. I saw it on Amazon. I actually bought it. It has not only you, it has Dwayne Hickman from Dobie Gillis, anyone from that era that had released singles, you know, songs, they have it now on a CD that people can buy. I didn't know if you were aware of that.
There's going to be a rush on it.
If you're not aware of it, we can tell your lawyer so they can look into that.
That piece of statues.
You can pull it up on Amazon.com.
I can't believe that.
Did you enjoy singing, doing that whole career?
No, I hated singing for Warner Brothers records. And I quit because a guy was... You remember how dumb his voice is? What kind of music is that?
And I met him on a football field. Can we tell Dale's president?
Absolutely.
You want to hear Dale's president?
Yeah!
But they were playing football on this field in Beverly Hills, and it's touch contact, which means you get bumped a little bit. And I'm really getting blown by this guy, and it was the first time in my life that I wanted to quit. I thought, I gotta walk off, this is brutal. And then the next thing is this man that was hitting me walks off, he's injured. And I said, there's a lesson here, never, never quit. And then he wasn't there to protect the quarterback. So I got in there because I was a linebacker in real life when I was a student, and I bounced this son of a bitch off the turf. Bang! I went, where's your bodyguard? You hit me pretty hard. I said, that's because you had the ball in your hand. I said, what's your name? Said, my name's Elvis. We met him. One more, can I tell you one more Elvis story?
Sure.
So he's got his entourage up at the hotel, the Wilshire Hotel. What was the name of that actor that stared at me at that?
There's a few.
I said actor at the Wilshire Hotel.
Sean Penn?
No, he was in that Italian restaurant.
Oh, that's right.
Al Pacino.
I can see how that would slip your mind.
Hey, he's a wonderful.
He's a hack. He is a great actor. Nice guy, too.
So anyway, the entourage is there. And I came with a lovely, lovely girl that I met at James Dean's grave in Fairmont, Indiana, where Jimmy lived. And anyway, we're just visiting, and Elvis says, I'm going to take you to see a movie. I said, why? He said, because I want to introduce you to this actress. I said, is she going to be watching the movie? He said, no, she's in the movie. I said, well, what movie? Maybe we can, you know, work something out. He said, no, she's from France. And it was Bridget Bardot, which was my first introduction to Bridget. Should she be in the movie?
Oh, yeah. You
said, never! That will never be in the book.
You heard it here, it was an exclusive. Remember to stay seated, because we're going to do the photographs in just a minute. They'll call you up one by one. But all the love you're about to hear is for you, Robert Conrad.